all that he's doing right now in my life.
Praise the Lord.
God is a good God.
Amen.
Yes, he is.
He's worthy to be praised.
Amen. All right, all right.
The God of peace.
Yes,
God.
Yes.
To pastor this church. I am certain to thank God for you. Why on this occasion, one that was set up in all the time.
Amen.
We thank God for the invitation to Garten, allowing things to move forward towards the day. I want to serve the time, and after I arrived here on the church lot, I had to look around and I thought even more Christians. Well, Walker has a lot of preaching buddies, friends. I said, but he asked me. And I wondered why, when I got here, continued to look around at all of these preachers and preaching God's word. And yet he chose me. Celebration of his 18 years. To all of the brethren in the ministry, my brothers in Christ, sisters in Christ, all of you who know Christ, who know me, who don't, you know Jesus.
Amen.
You know Jesus.
Yes.
That's all right.
Amen.
To the pastors, wives, preachers, ministers, wives, and young couples, and families, wives, and families. We honor you for today.
Amen.
And second, all of these first ladies here. Some folks don't agree with them, but I think it's all right with me to give honor to them.
Amen.
To my wife.
Amen.
I'm certainly so proud of her, and I thank God for her. Ever so long. Time is going on, moving on.
Yeah.
We had a good time sitting, didn't we?
Amen.
The Lord was here.
Amen.
Unless you were faking it, one of the two. You were faking it, but the Lord was here. I saw you jumping up and down. Either it was the rhythm or it was the Lord. I hope it was the Lord.
It was.
Because if it's the Lord, then there's still some movement that has to be done. Old English major say something got to be done.
Yeah.
That's what we are going through here. God is good. Y'all people are not going to let things change the course of time, just a little bit of it. Give me a clean heart. That's what I want. That I may serve you, Lord, fix my heart so that I can be used by you. See, I'm not worthy of all these. Pastors, according to my heart.
Mm-hmm.
Did you hear me?
Yes.
Which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding.
Yes. That's right.
Uh-huh. All I want to add to that is, if I could, you got the right man.
Amen.
Brother John.
Well, amen.
Did you hear what I said?
Yeah.
President Chapman.
Yes.
Of the West Virginia Baptist State Convention, I just want to acknowledge you, Pastor Chapman, and to my friend, Senior Pastor Reverend Devonport.
Well,
amen. God said to Jeremiah, and I will give you a pastor according to my heart. And if God gives you a pastor, girl, if he gives you a pastor, you believe it, and what do you believe it or not, if God gives it, you got the right man for the job.
All right.
A lot of people don't understand that you got the right man for the job. But I just want you to think for a few minutes about your condition in life. Well, what is my condition, Lord? Well, I was hurting last night, and I prayed to God that he would help me, that he would give me right direction, somebody to go to that I needed, that would lift this pain that I had. In other words, not just any doctor would do it. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
You have to have the right one, the right situation that you're in. And what do you know tonight, my brothers and sisters? We're looking. And if you'd ask my wife, she'd tell you, I got the right man for the job. Right man for the job that will love me and raise my kids, do all the things that fathers know how to do. Y'all pray with me.
Yeah.
And I don't believe that when we think about serving the Lord, when we think about the Lord and what he's doing for us, if he said that he would give us a pastor, then we ought to believe that the man that he placed over us is the man for the job.
That's right.
You got to believe that.
Amen.
Well, some folks want to know, and I'm going to tell you what was going on at this particular time in this third chapter of Jeremiah. Well, people were living a life of hopelessness.
Yeah.
Didn't believe in anything.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, they had false religion.
Uh-huh.
In other words, they said a lot with their mouths.
Uh-huh.
But their hearts was far from what they said.
Okay.
But God promised to give the people somebody that would lead them in the direction that they needed to go.
That's right.
I know a lot of times folks think that they can do all right and they don't need a preacher, and they can have a TV preacher, pastor, and all of these good things. But my brothers and sisters, God here put a pastor in place for a particular reason. In this case it was, as I said, they needed a leadership, somebody that would be willing to fill them with wisdom, fill them with knowledge and understanding. For God saw the lack of that audacia way that the people moved. They just moved on as if they didn't care. They didn't care whether they were true believers. It didn't matter to them how they looked to the world. All that it mattered was, you see, all that it mattered was a self-centeredness within their heart. He promised, you see,
He promised to give them not just a pastor, but one that was governed by his own law. Not just a pastor, but somebody that was governed with his own law. And I believe it was good because when we look over into John, he tells us that, yes, there are different shepherds, there are different pastors. And that's why he made it plain, because all are not as God has said, according to his heart. All are not in love. And all are not willing to take and give instructions from Jesus. And take those instructions and give them to the people regardless of how they feel. Go ahead. I'm trying to get started. The Lord is moving with me in heaven. They had something back then that looked like faith. They had something that looked like faith. Well, Pastor, what does faith look like? What does it look like if it is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen? Then how do they have the appearance of faith? What do they show? What is it that we see that makes us believe that these children are faith? Well, when Jesus spoke it, I understood it. When he said, I looked and I saw a man that was in need, and they brought him to me, and because they were persistent and because of their faith, they lift the roof off. He said, because I see your faith. A lot of folks say they have faith but not doing anything. A lot of folks want to be Christians but are not doing anything that it would take to be Christian. Well, what does it take to be a Christian? It takes instructions from God's word. A lot of folks say, I'm looking at the word, I hear the word, I read the word, but it hasn't. You can't apply to your life. So he's the man for the job. Been here 18 years. He is the man for the job that hadn't been discouraged to what people said. I believe that he's the man for the job, because probably, like so many others, if things doesn't go their way, they just quit going to church. I imagine every preacher that's on this pulpit or in the pews out there have been talked about like a dog. And if they had listened to those that talked about them, they would have stayed at home Sunday morning. And some of them may have been guilty of some things, but their love and their heart that God gave them wouldn't allow them to stay at home. Regardless of all that they said, they were the first ones at church. They were the first ones at church. Isn't that right? He's the man for the job. Because a lot of you who have been cursed out and called everything else, you'd have stayed at home, wouldn't you? Wouldn't be having appreciation day for you today. Because I'm tired of them folks. Yeah. You've been just satisfied just to stay at home. That's what they say. That's what they say. But you don't think about that, do you? You don't think about that. Sister so-and-so, is this appreciation? Yeah. Sister so-and-so fall out with sister so-and-so and never come back to church anymore. Yeah. Pastor falls out and he's the first thing on the podium in the morning. Amen. He's the first one up there to tell you that Jesus loves you and I do too. Amen. He's the first one that's telling you that you got to forgive if you want God to forgive you. He's the man for the job. Because he didn't quit. He hadn't given up. And I believe that when he got here 18 years ago, it was a lot of folks that was here then that are not here now. And it's not because death has called them, but it's because they have become member hovels.
I think church. Church hopper.
Church. The Lord said you need to settle out 2x2. Church hopper. You right, because they ain't no member. They just a hopper. And so, he put you here. Because everything that looked good on the other side. Every green grass on the other side of the hill. You might have checked it out, but you didn't stay. But some of the folks went over there to the church and they saw it and they stayed over there. They didn't know what it was over there. They just stayed because it appeared green. And their feelings was broke because when they looked back, all glory is green over there where I came from. Just man for the job. God promised to give us leaders and he's done that. Never falling short on his promise. He's filled us with wisdom and understanding for those that want to understand. God saw Israel going in the direction that was wrong. He loved them in such a way, in spite of their sinful nature, in spite of their sinful acts, God still chose a man to put in place, to try to cry out to the people, voice crying in the wilderness, to pardon the way of the Lord. You got the right man. You got the right man because I believe that he has not done everything right since he's been here. You got the right man because he has faltered sometimes, but yet still stayed course. He has fallen, but God, he trusted in God, and God has picked him up. And for 18 years, God is still yet turning the man for the job. Not an easy job. Not a real easy job at all. Because some folks said, you said too much of this, and you talk too much of that, and you don't give enough of that, and you got friends over there, and you don't care nothing about me. Y'all don't believe we hear all of that there. You need to get them straight, Pastor Walker, because he has the heart of God. God is dealing with him when he's not dealing with you. When he's crying to God and you happy. When he's sad because the congregation is a little bit weak on Wednesday night. He's praying that the church would increase, but others don't care. Other church members don't care.
They like it here.
If they care, they'd be out on Sunday morning. That's church school. I think I called it right then. Church school. They call it Sunday school. But it's church school. I think they started calling it Sunday school because some folks didn't, you know, was a part of the Acts movement where they had church daily. So they just wanted to go on Sunday. So they named it, changed it, and called it Sunday school. But there was a time that all of God's children that we worshiped 24 hours a day. I see the book of Acts. They worship daily in the house. He's the man for the job. I believe because God looked down some beginning of 18 years ago and saw that God needed somebody. Somebody that would stand for right and not wrong. Somebody that would, when you went to him, Sister Walker, for advice, they wouldn't give you, he wouldn't give you his advice.
All right. You got the Bible, you do it, don't you?
Don't give him his advice, but he studies up a little bit and he reads the word of God before he gives you the right instruction. Because I can tell you a lot of things, and none of them would mean a hill of bed. But if I tell you the truth, the truth will make you free. But it's not coming from me. the truth in the word of God, which is true. When God began to speak to you, that's why it's so important that we should read the word of God. Because there will be a time that God will speak to you through the word. But if you can't discern the word, I know the pastor telling you all the time, you need to pray and then you need to study. You need to pray and you need to study. Because wisdom has taught this pastor that you can't be a Christian without studying the word of God.
That's right. That's right.
You don't know how, but you can't preach the word.
I heard somebody say,
if you're running this race, then it must be some commitment on your part. It ought to be, when I say commitment on your part, sometimes commitment will make you feel bad.